Thank you all for rejoining us. We're going to go ahead and resume the conference. And I'd like to next welcome to the stage Jay Wexler, who is a professor at Boston University School of Law. He is also a former clerk for Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg, and today he'll speak to us about our non-Christian nation, how atheists, Satanists, Wiccans, and others are demanding their place in public life. Please join me in welcoming.
Well, hello, everybody. I'd like to thank the American Humanist Association for letting me come and speak, and I'd like to thank all of you here for coming and for everybody at home who's watching. As an atheist and humanist myself, it's very comfortable to speak to this to this group. It's fun to speak to all sorts of groups, but let's just put it this way. This is feels more friendly than like when I gave a talk at Liberty University. But anyways, I want to talk to you today about this project that I've been working on for the last couple of years, which culminates in this book that I'm publishing next week called Our Non-Christian Nation. And the project grew out of a couple of straightforward observations and facts, I think, about life in the United States, which are not particularly controversial, I don't think. The two facts are these. First of all, in the past 20 or so years, the Supreme Court of the United States has really torn down whatever walls there had been left between church and state, allowing religion, and what that means, of course, is Christianity, incredibly broad access to American public life, to government money, to government institutions, to government property. There are a number of cases that did this. I'll just name a couple. For example, there was the case of Van Orden versus Perry, which from 2005, which was the case where the Supreme Court said that the state of Texas could keep a Ten Commandments monument right on government property right in front of the Texas State Capitol. There was a case from 2002 called Zelman, which upheld Cleveland's voucher, school voucher program, even though 96% of the money in that program all went to Christian schools. There was the Town of Greece case from a couple of years ago where the Supreme Court said it's okay for town boards to invite people to come and start their town meetings off with a prayer, and that prayer can be as to Jesus as possible. Basically. So that's one fact, that we don't really have much of a separation of church and state these days. And the second fact, which has been alluded to already before today, is that the United States is becoming much more religiously diverse. So people who identify as Christians, their numbers are going down. People who identify with minority religions are growing. The nuns, as Paul Golan pointed out, make up something like a quarter of the population, people who identify with no particular religious belief at all. And so the question occurs, what should minorities do in this kind of post-separation of church and state nation? What is the role, what should they do? So there are three possibilities, I think. One possibility is they could keep fighting in the Supreme Court and in other courts for shut separation of church and state. That's one possibility. The second possibility is we could give up and do nothing and sort of cede the public square to Christians and to Christianity, the majority. But the third thing we could do is we could demand equal participation in public life alongside the Christian majority. Because all the cases that I mentioned and other cases as well that the Supreme Court has decided that tore down the wall between separation of church and state, they're about Christians. They're cases that are brought or challenged or challenging Christian participation in public life, but the cases are not limited to Christians, and in fact, the courts are pretty good at saying that the government has to treat all religions equally. Courts aren't perfect on that. In fact, just a couple of weeks ago, or maybe a month ago, the D.C. Circuit Court of Appeals decided that it was okay for the House of Representatives not to allow Dan Barker, the head of the FFRF, Freedom From Religion Foundation, to give an invocation in front of the House of Representatives. And the judge who wrote that was the judge that I worked for, and this incenses me. It's the D.C. Circuit, so it's only, well, that's actually pretty important when it comes to the House of Representatives. So anyways, the courts have been pretty good but not great about saying that the government has to treat all religious and non-religious people equally. So those are the three choices. Give up, keep fighting for separation of church and state, or demand equal participation. Now, when I first started working on this project a few years ago, the idea of continuing to fight for separation of church and state in the courts, especially the Supreme Court, was still a pretty good option, I thought, because Hillary Clinton was running for president, remember? And if she had made it on the court, she probably would have appointed some people who were more friendly to separation of church and state than people she was replacing. But actually, Donald Trump became president. Just kind of take a break. Breathe. You don't know what's in there. Appointed Gorsuch and Kavanaugh, and it seems unlikely that the court's going to go back to a separation of church and state regime anytime soon. Of course, in the next couple of weeks, we're going to find out what the court does in the American Humanist, American Legion case, where the American Humanists were challenging the 40-foot cross on public property in Maryland. And I actually went to that oral argument. I don't go to many oral arguments at the Supreme Court, but I went to that argument sort of in a masochistic way, because I just somehow wanted to see what they were going to talk about. And the idea that they were that the court kind of debated for 70 minutes about whether a 40-foot cross is a religious symbol or not, just astonishing, really. It was just astonishing to try to watch the court try to figure out how a gigantic cross might not be a religious symbol. But anyways, so we'll see what happens in that case. Hopefully, it's almost certain that the court will uphold the cross. But the question will be how narrow the opinion will be. So we'll see what happens. So fighting in the courts, in the Supreme Court, that's not going to really help that much anymore, at least until we get another president and some new justices. So that leaves two options: either do nothing and cede the public life to Christians, or to demand equal participation in public life alongside Christians. And it's really important to recognize that that's the choice, right? It's either do nothing, in which case it's Christian public square, or do something, in which case we can minorities and atheists and humanists can participate alongside Christians. That's the choice. And so what I want to explain in the rest of this talk, and what I explain in my book, is are two things. One is that many minorities have, in fact, over the past decade or so, started demanding their rightful place in public life alongside the Christian majority. And then the second thing I want to argue is that that's a good thing for a variety of reasons. So, first, the sort of descriptive part, which is, in fact, we have seen over the last 10 years, maybe a little bit more actual participation in public life by religious minorities and atheists. And so, I like to think of the areas of participation in sort of four groups. I know people say the word buckets now a lot. Four buckets, but I hate that. Okay, so four groups. There are invocations. There are invocations before town boards and legislatures. That's one. They're putting up symbols and displays on public property is two. The third is starting after school clubs. This is something I hadn't mentioned before, but the Supreme Court held in this case called Good News Club that from 2001, I think, or that if a public school opens up its classrooms after the school day is over to after school activities, the Democrats club, the lacrosse team, whatever, it has to also allow religious groups to be able to use those rooms. Not just to talk about religion, but even if they're there to proselytize six-year-olds into the Christian faith. So a third group of these of public participation is the creation of after-school kind of clubs in public schools, and then the fourth group is the application for government money. Following this school voucher case that I mentioned before, it's possible for theoretically anyways, for a school of any kind to, if they're in the right place, to be a school voucher school and receive vouchers from the government. So those are the four areas, and we have seen in each of those areas more participation by religious minorities and atheists in public life. So just some examples. There have been a many, many, don't know the exact number, but probably in the hundreds, if not more than 1,000, secular invocations given before, invocations before town boards in the last few years. It's and sometimes it actually goes fairly smoothly. Like, sometimes there's a big problem, and the town members of the town board get up and leave when an atheist, for example, gets up and gives an invocation. But many times it goes fairly smoothly, and you have an atheist or a secularist of some sort get up and give a two-minute, basically, talk about what it means to be a humanist or what it means to be an atheist. For my book, I like to travel around to different places, get out of the office and go talk to people and visit places where things are happening. And so one thing I did was I went to the town of Greece, which was the town where this big Supreme Court case came from. And I saw Linda Stevens, who was one of the plaintiffs who sued her town board and lost in the Supreme Court. Then, a couple years later, give an atheist invocation before that same board. Which was great. I thought it was fabulous. I wanted to see if there was any controversy, going to be any controversy. There wasn't. The guy next to me took off his hat when they said there's going to be a prayer, and then when she started talking and it was clear to him that it wasn't really a prayer, he put his hat back on. But that was like the only thing that happened that was out of the ordinary. So that was terrific. When it comes to symbols and displays in the public square, we've seen recently lots of different atheist and humanist and secular displays. There's the atheist bench in Florida, right? Not that exciting, but it's there and it's still there, and nobody's tried to do anything bad to it. It's a bench because atheists and humanists believe that things should be useful, and so you can sit on it and rest. It's not that useful, but it's a little useful. There are holiday displays that go up during the Christmas Hanukkah time, which celebrate atheism. Those kinds of symbols have been put up in state houses around the nation, often by Freedom From Religion Foundation. One of my favorite stories from my book, which is not about an atheist or a humanist group, it's about a Wiccan group, is about the fight that the Wiccans entered into with the United States government to be allowed to put a Wiccan pentacle on a national cemetery tombstone. This happened maybe 10 years ago. Lots of Wiccans in the military. This one woman's husband died in Afghanistan. They wanted to put a Wiccan pentacle on the tombstone. It was not one of the approved symbols. Interestingly, there is an atheist symbol. Was an atheist, continues to be, but there was no Wiccan pentacle, and so they wouldn't let her put the Wiccan pentacle on. So she sued. And during discovery of the lawsuit, what they found out was that, in fact, the United States government did not approve the Wiccan pentacle because they didn't like witches. Like, that was in the record. Now you can get the Wiccan pentacle on your... So they won that case. The government settled. After school clubs, there we see the Secular Students Association, which was brought up in the last talk, which is a great group. I went to their conference. I haven't spent much time involved with them, but I wanted to see what they were doing, and it's just a fabulous, energetic group of people, college students mostly, but also high school students who are working to create secular spaces in the public schools, and they run into problems all the time, of course. Camp Quest is not in the public schools, but it's similar, and there's a story in the book about the time that the public school teachers would not put the pamphlet in the take-home materials. And maybe you could speak more about that if you wanted to. But
that was like 40 miles from where I live right now. And we'd love to get back to the schools.
Yeah, and you have every right to. So that's the thing. And finally, applying for government money. Atheists, as far as I know, have not received much government money, but other religious minority groups have. Muslims run there are a number of Muslim schools in the United States that receive voucher money. Of course, every once in a while, you'll find a legislator in a state that's considering whether to make a voucher program, all of a sudden realize that the money's gonna not just go to Christian schools, but also to Muslim schools, and then they're like, oh, we can't have a voucher program. That's happened many times. And then, of course, there's the Satanic Temple, which I don't know how much you know about the Satanic Temple. I'm a big fan of the Satanic Temple. They're an atheist group, but they believe, they worship or they venerate the symbol of Satan as kind of a rebellion against oppressive authority. And they actually are in Cambridge, but they have chapters everywhere. And for example, if there's a Ten Commandments monument somewhere, they will say, we would like to you to also put up our 8-foot bronze, $100,000 statue of Baphomet, this occult, goat-headed occult figure, next to the Ten Commandments, to which people generally say no. And then there are lawsuits and fights about that. And of course, they also started an after-school Satan group. That maybe hasn't gone as well as some of their other initiatives, but the Satanic Temple is very interesting. I'll come back to them in a minute. So that's the descriptive point, is that in fact we have seen a lot of religious minorities and atheists, humanists, etc., partake in public life using these Supreme Court opinions and decisions to say, hey, we have the right to government money, to government property, to government institutions, just like Christians. Now the final question then is, why is this good, or is it good at all? Because most religious minorities and atheists, etc., believe in the separation of church and state, because one of the best things about separation of church and state is that it protects minorities from government support of what's usually majority religion, right? And so we're used to supporting separation of church and state, so the question might be, why should we get behind state support of religion or state support of, you know, positions that are, you know, counter to religion, which I take as really being the same group of, they're in the same category to me. Why would atheists want to get state support when we generally don't like government support of religious positions, whether positive or negative? And that's a great question, and I think it does take a sort of reorientation to understand why this is a good thing, this phenomenon is a good thing. And of course, it's good at this point to remember that the options are cede the public square to Christians or demand equal participation. If we could keep fighting in the Supreme Court, oh no, I really failed. Ooh, now I made it worse. Okay, sorry. I had one job. So the Supreme Court's not going to help, not yet. Going to the courts for redress isn't going to really solve anything. So why participate in public life? A couple different reasons. One is, counterintuitively, it may lead to a secular public square, right? This is what the Satanic Temple has demonstrated, that if religious minorities, and particularly Satanism, they're very good at this, say we want to be part of public life too, oftentimes the government will simply say, all right, forget it, no more religion in public life, rather than saying we'll share the stage with Satan. This happens all the time. It happened in Phoenix. The city council of Phoenix had this program where they started every meeting off with a prayer or an invocation. The Satanic Temple said, we'd like to also give an invocation. The city said, sure, of course, that's under our guidelines, we have to. And then the people of Phoenix found out about it and went insane. And they held this 3-hour meeting all about how we were not gonna let Satan into Phoenix, and they took out dollar bills and said, look, it says God, not Satan, and all this stuff. And eventually they just said, well, we'll have a moment of silence instead of letting the Satanists come once a year for 2 minutes. So, and that's happened in different contexts and in different places around the country. So, in fact, that's point one, is that counterintuitively demanding participation in public life can be a way of actually causing the secularization of public life once Christian majority realizes they're not the only one. Second, though, is even if the majority lets the minorities in into public life, I think that's better than having a purely Christian public square. Now, it's messy. I like to call it religious cacophony. You know, imagine a space like the Maryland public, the ground where that 40-foot cross is. And imagine the 40-foot cross, it has to be a little bigger for this to work, but the space, not the cross. The cross can't be any bigger. 40-foot cross, and then there's also a Satan monument, and then there's the 40-foot happy humanist hand thing that Monica Miller brought up at the Supreme Court oral argument. She was fantastic. Have a Hindu sculpture. That's messy. It's cacophonous. But I really actually kind of like it. And I think there are things that speak in favor of it, even if it's maybe not quite as good as having a completely secular public square. Pluralism, I think, is just a good in itself. I think the public life is more interesting, it's more invigorating, it's more exciting if there's lots of stuff out there. I think it's empowering for religious minorities and atheists to partake in public life. I mean, if you talk to people who've done this, like Linda Stevens, for example, she'll tell you that it was empowering to get up there and give a two-minute invocation and talk about secularism and why it's okay to be, why you can be good without God. I also think it's educational. Now we get a little more dicey, right? I do think that if you have a public square that's filled with lots of different kinds of religious monuments and invocations and clubs, etc., that there'll be more education about religious minorities. People will see what religious minorities are doing, what they believe in, what they stand for, and will have a better appreciation, hopefully, not every time, not all at once, maybe, of course, but over time, gradually, a lot of people will learn about what it is means to be a Jew, or what it means to be a Hindu, or a Buddhist, or a humanist. And then finally, and this is the most sort of hopeful thing, although I would imagine there's some pushback here, is that if we have more education about religious minorities and the diversity of religion in America, we may also have, in the long run, more tolerance, mutual respect, and social peace. Now, maybe I'm wrong about that, but I think that if you had 50 years of religious minorities and atheists partaking in public life alongside Christians, we might get to a mutual understanding and a sort of detente, maybe, if you will, in these religious battles that we seem to always be engaged in. But I won't say much more about that because I don't think we have to even get there for this proposal, for my position to work. But I do sort of think that that might be true, and that's sort of my optimistic view. So that's all I have. We have, I think, about 10 minutes, 8 minutes or something like that for questions. If anybody would like to ask a question, I'm happy to answer.
Hi. I'm from Maryland. I live in Greenbelt, and I know about the case with the cross.
Do you drive by it all the time?
Occasionally I drive by. Mm-hmm. But the way,
I've seen pictures of it.
Okay,
yes.
Well, anyway, the people who want to keep the cross are saying they're going to destroy it, tear it. We don't want them to, you know, we want them to move it somewhere else because it is on government property. You can't even really, it's in the middle of like a highway median.
Right.
So you can't even stop. There's no place to park or anything.
Right.
But it was supposed to honor, I guess, the veterans
World
from
War
World
I,
War
veterans.
I. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And then I wanted to make some comments on another issue, maybe kind of a... we live in a housing development where there's no solicitation of it. It's not allowed. The big sign says no solicitation. Mm-hmm. We get people all the time coming, and we would call the cops because we get a lot of religious people coming. We get mostly Mormons and Jehovah's Witnesses that come. Mm-hmm. When we talked to the town, they said there's two protected groups with solicitation. That's if you're doing a political thing and if you're religious. So if, you know, we had so many people coming, I don't answer the door anymore.
Uh-huh. Well, don't you want to go around and solicit yourself? And say, hi. Or when they come, you mm-hmm. could give them some materials.
Yeah. Just have them greeted by a huge statue of Satan.
But, I mean, they don't take no for an answer. And then I finally, because that's a big problem in our areas. Uh-huh. We get a lot of solicitations of people who are not supposed to be there, well, the same folks. One time I had 4 people in one day from the same group coming.
Wow. So. Could I ask you this question? Do you know if when the government says there are 2 protected classes, mm-hmm. if they mean that in their regulations they say nobody can go door to door except if they are religious?
Yeah, that's what I was uh-huh. told, except uh-huh. those.
So, uh-huh. so it's not because... There's no constitutional right to do that, but at the same time, it is probably okay for the government to make an exception for religion. But that is something that's really subject to the political process. Like mm-hmm. if there was some way to change that regulation, mm-hmm. it could be changed without violating the Constitution. So, but you know, that's a big fight. Who wants to do that? But take your point.
Very thank you.
You're welcome.
Hi.
Hello.
This is an answer to that. When I've had those solicitations, I've invited them in, and they sit down, and I give them something to drink or something, and I do all the talking. And they usually do this and flee. That's wonderful. It's a wonderful opportunity to give them a spiel about humanism and non-theism and all kinds of good
yeah,
things.
I mean, if you're up for it, like not everybody's up for doing that four times a day. What are you? But if you're up for it, by all means.
So you teach at BU Law School.
Go Terriers.
Well. Maybe not. Do you get involved in pro bono work on constitutional issues in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts?
Almost never, no.
Why?
Well, I don't know how to... I wouldn't really be of much help to any actual person who wanted to vindicate their legal rights, because I don't know really how to practice much. You know, I do, like, I talk to people who do that. Like, if I might get a call, you know, saying, can I talk to you about this issue? And then I would talk to them, of course. But I don't have any particular, I never litigated. I worked for a couple of years for the Justice Department, so I can write a memo, but that's
all right. Memo. Two things about what you might want to get with which you might want to get involved. Number one, within the Commonwealth of Massachusetts, there is a statute that provides historical rehabilitation of buildings. At least 95%, I'm pretty sure it's 100%, of all buildings restored are churches, mm-hmm. Most of which are currently operating churches.
Mm-hmm. This was a question on my First Amendment exam just three
cool.
weeks ago.
Cool. Secondly, a significant number of places where people cast a ballot are churches. Mm-hmm. So the government is paying rent to churches. In both cases, that church may not have survived when their roof started leaking because they couldn't afford to fix it, other than the government resources. The second, there are a lot of places that the government could have places to vote without giving money to churches. Are you in?
I'm in. Absolutely.
Talk to me later.
Okay. I want to respond a little bit to what people were talking about the solicitation, et cetera. And I live in New York City, and so I guess I look Jewish. So it's not uncommon for me to be walking down the street and you'll see people who are looking to proselytize who will ask me, are you Jewish? And then it's a very difficult question for me to answer because on the one hand, I'm very reluctant to say no, because I do regard myself as culturally and ethnically Jewish, even though I am an atheist and a secularist. So I don't like to say no because I feel like I'm, you know, hiding something. But I know that if I say yes, they go, well, come on, let's pray with us. Let's, you know, and it's... So I actually developed an answer to that. And I've tried it out a few times, and it's worked very well. If someone come down, you know, I was in an elevator with someone, you know, some young Hasids who were obviously out trying to, you know, proselytize to people. And they said, look, young man looked at me and said, are you Jewish? And I looked at him for a few seconds and I said, do we know each other? And he said, no. And I said, well, I don't talk about my religion to strangers on the street, my religious beliefs. And that sort of like, you know, pushed him off a little bit. But I have a question for you. I don't know if you would call me a textualist when it comes to the Constitution, but one of the things that I look at, and I know from a practical standpoint, I agree with what you said about, you know, more religions, different aspects in the public square. But I look at the Constitution, and it says, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion. It does not say, although it could have said, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of any one particular religion. But that's not what it says. So I'm wondering how you look at that, you know, particular argument. I understand what you're saying from the first part, that, yeah, I could take that from the Supreme Court and I would lose. I mean, you know, in the current Supreme Court, but I still think it's a viable argument.
And
what do you think?
What would the implications of that be, then?
Like, in terms of what?
Why is that distinction?
Because the distinction is that when you're saying if it's said Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of any one particular religion, that would seem to me to, I would understand from a legal standpoint, the idea that of the Supreme Court decisions that say, well, yes, as long as you reach out to other religions, et cetera, that's okay. But it's not what the Constitution says. Mm-hmm. It says the Constitution says Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion at all. So I just think that those decisions, again, it's just my point of view, but I think those decisions are wrong. Uh-huh. I understand what you're coming from, but it just rankles me a little. I mean, I don't disagree with you.
So you think, like, if they put up a 40-foot cross, that's an establishment of a religion, but not an establishment of religion?
I think it's an establishment of a religion, of Christianity.
I wish we had buzzers, because I think you could disagree even on that. Even if we grant your premise that that distinction makes a difference, I still think one could say it's an establishment of religion to put up a cross,
yes.
Right? Not
right.
Just an establishment of a religion,
right.
But what are you doing when you put up a cross? You are saying that it's a version of religion, right? But it is religion.
But is one
certainly from the perspective of this group, right?
Right.
Which is very in a sense is not, doesn't believe in any religion, right?
Right. But it's still one particular religion. I mean, there's okay, a cross is one religion. I mean, and when you were talking about before in the sense of that 40-minute ridiculous argument about whether your ridiculous argument whether a giant cross is religion, I'm sure that if I were to desecrate it and that particular state had laws against desecrate, if I were to spray paint on it, this thing sucks, they would come after me for having desecrated a religious symbol, right? I mean, you say it's not a religious symbol, well, then I'm allowed to spray paint whatever the hell I want on it. I mean, apart from the fact that it's not my personal property. And I certainly could be prosecuted for that particular thing, for desecration of some, for not desecration, but for marring somebody else's property, but not for desecrating a religious symbol. But I'm sure that that's not how they would look at it.
I think that's a great argument as to why the cross is unconstitutional.
Yeah. Okay.
So we'll leave on. Thank you very much.
So sorry.
No, fantastic.
Peace.